Hello there, students. Thank you for being part of this presentation. My name is Luis Silva, and today we're looking at world history, the age of absolute monarchs, and we're covering the period from about the 1600 all the way to the 1750s. Let's move on. What is absolutism? Absolutism is the political doctrine and practice of unlimited centralized authority and absolute sovereignty as vested especially in a monarch or a dictator. King Louis XIV of France is the prime example of an absolute ruler when he said, "I am the state." The age of absolute monarchs was very important because it helped rulers gain power and create powerful nations. By the end of the Renaissance, new nations were formed in Europe. Many of these nations were ruled by powerful kings with unlimited power known as absolute monarchs. The era from about the 1600s all the way to the mid-1700s became known as the Age of Absolutism. But how did European kings were able to gain so much power? During the Middle Ages, European kings were not very powerful. Instead, feudal lords had real power because they controlled local manors and also had the loyalty of knights. The Catholic Church was the dominant religion in Europe. The Pope had the power over the peasants. The Crusades stimulated trade and led to the rise of cities in Europe. And as feudalism declined, the power of the kings increased. Here we have a map to the right in which you see how Europe was around this time period, and you see how most of Europe was Christian at that particular time period. In the also to the top right, you see the city of Florence, very prosperous. This became obviously part of the Renaissance, as Florence was able to lead the way during the Renaissance in terms of economic growth and trade. This trade sparked the Renaissance and weakened the power of all feudal lords. During the Hundred Years' War, new weapons like the cannon and longbow weakened the power of the nobles and knights. As feudalism declined, also the power of the kings increased dramatically. The power of the Catholic Church was weakened as a result of the Crusades and the Protestant Reformation. And as the power of the church declined, the power of kings increased. During the Renaissance, kings taxed merchants and bankers and used the money they collected to build powerful armies. Monarchs used their power and built centralized governments to control their nations, to control the people within their nations. Some monarchs used overseas exploration to gain colonies and increase their wealth and power. This is what we see during the Age of Exploration. Many nations such as Spain, England, and many other nations were acquiring territories, colonies, for their own benefit. By the 1600s, some European kings had become absolute monarchs already. For example, Philip II of Spain, Louis XIV of France, Frederick the Great of Prussia, Peter the Great of Russia, and Maria Theresa of Austria. Absolute monarchy is a form of government in which one king should hold all the power within a country. Absolute monarchs were able to control all aspects of their nations. This included collecting taxes, dictating what religion was going to be practiced, controlling the military, as well as controlling the economy of that particular country. Absolute monarchs also believed in the concept of divine right, the idea that God created a monarchy and kings answer only to God and not the people. By the way, this idea was challenged by all the Enlightenment thinkers as they opposed the idea of absolute monarchs. And right here we have Louis XIV of France. Take a few minutes, pause the video, and see what made Louis XIV an absolute monarch. Do you see anything in his clothes? Do you see anything where he's standing? Do you see anything related to his glory? Think about it. Now, how was France before King Louis XIV came to power? Before Louis XIV came to power, France was a nation in conflict between Catholics and French Protestants, also known as Huguenots. King Henry IV tried to fix this problem by declaring religious toleration, which was called the Edict of Nantes. After Henry IV died, Catholic leaders took control of France, ended the Edict of Nantes, weakened the power of the nobles, and increased the power of the monarchy. By the time Louis XIV came to power, France was an absolute monarchy already. Louis XIV was able to rule France for 72 years and became the classic example of an absolute monarchy. Louis XIV believed that he was the government. He excluded nobles from government decisions and hired bureaucrats to collect taxes and also enforce laws. Louis XIV called himself the Sun King because he felt that French power emanated from him. Louis XIV had some positive impacts on France. Let's see what those impacts or positive impacts are. His economic advisors were able to use overseas colonies and mercantilism to generate wealth for France. He encouraged manufacturing to make France self-sufficient. With his wealth, Louis was able to build a powerful army and transform France into the most powerful nation in Europe. Let's look at some of the negative impact of Louis XIV on France. He involved France in expensive wars that failed to gain France new lands, and this led to massive debts for France. He also used his wealth and art to glorify himself, including the construction of a massive palace called the Versailles. And here you have images of the palace still around today. As a matter of fact, as of 2003, it was estimated that the cost was about $2.5 billion. Very expensive project. And this was all meant to glorify Louis XIV. And the legacy of Louis XIV, you see how he left basically France broke with so much debt. As a result of Louis XIV, France became, on one hand, the most powerful nation, but many decades of crazy spending by monarchs led to massive debts and heavy, heavy taxes on people that they could not pay. Eventually, the French people became very angry and they decided to overthrow the monarchy, and as a result, the French Revolution took place. And here we have an image, a picture of Peter the Great of Russia. Russia before Peter the Great. Russia was influenced by the Byzantine Empire, but was conquered by the Mongols. And here you have a map also color-coded with how Russia was around 1294. Ivan III successfully liberated Russia from the Mongols and ruled as the first Tsar or Caesar or King. Over time, Tsars expanded Russia's borders and increased their power over the nobles and created an absolute monarchy. By the time Peter the Great became Tsar in 1682, Russia was a large empire. But Russia was not as advanced as Western nations, as European nations in this case. One of the reasons why Russia was not very advanced, it was because of its isolation. Russia was isolated from Western Europe and knew very little about the new ideas of the Renaissance. While European nations grew wealthy from trade, made cultural advances, and had strong economies, Russia had no advanced industry, no overseas colonies, and an economy of small-scale farmers. Most Russians were feudal peasants working for nobles around this time, and this limited Russia in growing economically. Tsar Peter the Great had a vision for Russia, and he wanted to modernize and westernize Russia to catch up, according to him, with Europe. In disguise, he was able to go around Europe to learn new ways, and those ways were meant to modernize Russia. While in Europe, Peter learned new ideas about shipbuilding, manufacturing, government organization, city planning, music, and fashion, and he was able to use all of that information he gained back in Russia. When he returned from Europe, Peter imposed new reforms to westernize Russia. He adopted European fashions by banning beards for men and veils for women, adopted a European calendar also, improved farming techniques, used mercantilism as an economic policy, created iron and lumber factories, modernized the army and navy, and made himself head of the Orthodox Church, like Henry VIII in England. Peter was able to expand Russia's borders as he built a new European-style Russian capital at St. Petersburg. Now let's look at the legacy of Peter the Great. As a result of Peter the Great, Russia became more advanced, and a lot of the ideas from Western European nations were adopted by him, and they worked well enough in Russia. But modernization was a slow process, and Russia had not fully industrialized by World War I. During World War I, revolutionaries were able to overthrow the monarchy and created a radical new government based on socialism. Now let's look at England, in this case Elizabeth I of England. Let's look at England before Queen Elizabeth I. Unlike other nations in Europe, England had a limited monarchy rather than an absolute monarchy. During the Middle Ages, English nobles revolted against a cruel king who overtaxed them. In 1215, nobles forced King John to sign the Magna Carta, which limited the king's power and protected citizens' rights. The Magna Carta created a limited monarchy and led to the formation of Parliament in 1295. Parliament is a legislative group of commoners and lords who work with the king to pass laws and taxes. Now let's review some of the history behind Henry VIII and how his descendants were able or controlled England. Elizabeth's father, Henry VIII, transformed England during the Protestant Reformation by creating the Anglican Church. After Henry's death, his son Edward became king, but he died at the age of 15. Elizabeth's sister became the queen, in this case Mary, and tried to convert England back to Catholicism. Protestants, which were many, who ignored her, were executed. That's why she's also known as Bloody Mary. After Mary's death in 1558, Elizabeth became Queen of England. Elizabeth ruled for 45 years and became the greatest monarch in English history. Elizabeth refused to share power with anybody, and therefore she did not marry anybody, and that's why she's known as the Virgin Queen. During her reign, Queen Elizabeth worked with Parliament to settle important issues. One of the most important issues was to determine what religion England would be, that was either Anglican or Catholic. As we know, Henry VIII made himself the head of the church and introduced the Bible in English, did not change church services. Edward VI, Henry's son, was a strong Protestant. He introduced new prayer books, had church services in English, allowed priests to marry, and destroyed church decorations. Now Mary, or Bloody Mary, Henry's daughter, was a very strong Catholic. The Pope was made head of the church again, church services changed to Latin, priests were not allowed to marry, and she also persecuted Protestants. In order to solve the problem of selecting either Anglican or Catholic religions in England, Elizabeth and Parliament passed the Act of Uniformity, which made Anglicanism the official religion of England. But Catholics still kept traditions and rituals. This compromise settled the religious issues in England. She also promoted capitalism and mercantilism by encouraging joint stock companies to invest in overseas exploration as well as colonization. And if you can see the map there, all the red dots, different parts of the world are English territories that were acquired. During Elizabeth's reign as queen, England experienced a golden age in culture, especially in literature and theater. Now, after Elizabeth's death in 1603, the Stuart family assumed the monarchy in England. Unlike Elizabeth, these Stuart kings refused to work with Parliament and tried to create an absolute monarchy in England. Conflicts between Parliament and the Stuart kings led to a violent civil war in 1642 and a near civil war in 1688, which is known as the Glorious Revolution. After the Glorious Revolution, Parliament required the new monarch to sign a Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights protected citizens from their government and basically said that the king cannot tax or overturn Parliament's laws, protected freedom of speech, the army cannot be used as a police force, and also no excess bail. Together, the Magna Carta and the Bill of Rights created what became known as a constitutional monarchy in England by serving as a written limit on the power of the king. And if we're going to make connections to today in reference to U.S. democracy, today the United States still relies on many of the government reforms and institutions that the English developed during their period. This includes the following: the right to obtain habeas corpus, a document that prevents authorities from holding a person in jail without being charged, a Bill of Rights guaranteeing such rights as freedom of speech and freedom to worship, and a strong legislature and a strong executive which act as checks on each other. We have come to the end of this presentation. Please do not forget to subscribe, and I will see you in the next presentation.